Assalamu alaikum. This is the presentation of the third lecture in the central nervous system histology. The third lecture in the central nervous system, it will cover the description of the short tracts in the spinal cord, the pyramidal of its two parts, corticospinal and corticobulbar, and the extrapyramidal tracts. Together, we will collect now what are the fixed short tracts and what are the fixed descending tracts in the spinal cord. Starting with the short tracts, we have four short tracts. The first one is present around the gray matter of the spinal cord, all the levels. And it is called fasciculi propri, meaning a proper fascicle, or intersegmental tract because it connects different segments with each other. It is formed by axons coming from these associative nuclei, which are present between the posterior sensory and anterior motor. These nuclei are associative. They send axons that will pass in the white matter surrounding the gray matter in the form of a ring. We have a posterior part, we have a lateral part, we have a ventral or anterior part. And it will ascend or descend so that we have ascending fibers and descending fibers to connect different segments. Actually, it connects the cervical segments with the lumbar segments for the coordination of the different regions of the spinal cord. And actually, it is the first to be myelinated in the newly born, so to coordinate early movement of the fetus. The first to be myelinated in the fetus to coordinate the early movement of the newly born. Here, this coordination is carried out by these axons coming from the associative nuclei, passing through the white matter in the form of a ring around the gray matter, ascend and descend to join different segments with each other. Very evident in the movement of the horse, where you can see that there is the movement of the forelimb here for forward movement and the hind limb backward movement. Here, the reverse, we have backward movement of the forelimb, forward movement of the hind limb. This coordination is not taken by chance. It is due to the coordination formed by the fasciculi propri, which will coordinate the movement of the upper limb and lower limbs in the newly born, as it is the first one to be myelinated in the fetal stage. Here we will have also another short tract that was discussed before in the previous lecture. It is the Lissauer's tract. The Lissauer's tract, as we know, it ascends and descends at the tip of the dorsal horn in all the segments of the spinal cord. It is formed by branches that ascend one or two segments and descend one or two segments, coming from the cells present in the dorsal root ganglia receiving the pain and temperature sensation. These cells are the mother cells of this tract. This tract is formed by these short fibers all through the spinal cord, not leaving the spinal cord, so it is a short tract. The fibers here will finally terminate in the second order neuron to complete the pain and temperature pathway, which is the substantia gelatinosa of Rolandi on the same side. It is a first order neuron carrying the pain and temperature from the same side of the body. Notice here that every segment has fibers coming from above, fibers coming from below, and in addition to those entering to the same level. So we have an area of overlap here for this segment. This segment here has fibers coming from up, fibers coming from down, and in addition to the entry at the level and the same level. So we have a form of overlap here. Here it is the position of the Lissauer's tract to relay in the substantia gelatinosa of Rolandi at the tip of the posterior horn. Remember, it is present in all the levels of the spinal cord. As another short tracts will be the coma-shaped and the septomarginal. Here we know that the proprioceptive impulses will be carried by the sigmalinated, which are peripheral branches of the larger cells in dorsal root ganglia, and the central branches will enter through the medial division and give an ascending long tract, which is the coma in the upper half and the gracile in the lower half of the body. Here we have a short descending branch coming from this coma, which will actually relay with the relay neuron that will relay with the anterior horn cell. So it connects these impulses here to the anterior horn cell. These impulses are emitted in the resting condition with no evident stimulation of proprioceptors. We have a minimal stimulation. This due to the presence of the muscle in an area which is longer than its length, so it is slightly stretched, causing stimulation of these receptors that will send the impulses carried by the peripheral branches, and the central will enter by the medial division. But here the impulses will not pass through the pathway to the cerebral cortex because it is in rest, so it will pass through this descending branch to stimulate finally the anterior horn cell. That will cause a slight contraction in the muscle, and this is called the muscle tone, to make the muscle tense and ready for the contraction, for the vigorous contraction. Here the short branch coming from the coma shaped is called, of coming from the cuneate, is called the coma shaped tract because its shape is coma, as we will see now. But the descending branch from the gracile is called septomarginal because it is very close to this septum. So it is called septomarginal, and this is called coma shaped. This is according to its position, and this is according to its shape. This is related to the cuneate, and this is related to the gracile, and they are responsible for the muscle tone. Here the picture of the septomarginal coming at descending branch from the gracile to reach the anterior horn cell finally. And we should remember that this descending branch is present in the lumbar and in all the thoracic segments, and it is absent in the cervical segment. And as we have said, this descending branch will form impulse, will send the impulses to the relay that will connect to the anterior horn cell, that will give the impulse to the muscle, making the muscle tone. Here is the position of the coma shaped related to the cuneate, and here is the position of the septomarginal related to the gracile. Remember, this is the picture of the upper thoracic, where we can see the septomarginal and the coma shaped together. As actually we have said that the coma shaped is descending from the cuneate, and it is present in cervical and upper thoracic. But in case of septomarginal, it descends from the gracile, but it is present in the sacral, lumbar, lower thoracic, upper thoracic, but absent in the cervical. Actually, no need for its presence as we have the coma. But in this area where there is a transition between the septomarginal and the coma shaped, we have both of them are present, no sudden or sharp transition from one to the other. So in the upper thoracic, we have both of them. Here we can remember that we have six ascending fixed tract present in all the segments of the spinal cord, which are the gracile, the ventrospinocerebellar, the lateral spinothalamic, ventrospinothalamic, spinotectal, and spinoolivary. And also we have two fixed short tracts, which are the Lissauer's tract here at the tip of the posterior horn, and the fasciculi propri forming a ring around the gray matter in all the levels of the spinal cord. Here we have very important clinical application, which is the tapis dorsalis. Here we have it is a symptom of the syphilis disease, where there is a destruction in the fibers in the posterior root, especially in the lumbosacral region. So it will affect the sensory fibers carrying the proprioception, mainly here passing through the posterior root to form the gracile tract. So in this condition, we will have hypotonia. Why? Because here we have lost the ascending fibers carrying the proprioception from the muscle spindle, tendon spindle, bassinial corpuscle that will form the septomarginal to reach the anterior horny cell, so to maintain the muscle tone, so we don't have this connection due to the loss of the afferent impulses coming from the proprioceptors, so we have a hypotonia. At the same time, we have loss of ankle and knee reflexes, which depend on these proprioceptive impulses coming from the posterior root, and also we will have sensory ataxia also due to destruction of the gracile tract. First, here this is a picture of the knee reflex. Here we have tapping by this hammer on the on this tendon here, and then what will happen, we have afferent impulses coming from the posterior root cells and will pass to the anterior horny cell, and this will cause contraction of the muscle, so the limb will be moving here forwards due to contraction of the quadriceps muscle. This is the knee reflex. Due to the loss of these fibers carrying the proprioception in the lower lumbosacral region, this reflex will be lost. And the same also for the ankle reflex. Here we have a picture for the knee reflex.
Briskly tap the tendon just below the patella. Feel for contraction of the quadriceps and look for extension of the knee. These are 2+ responses. To test the ankle reflex, extend the patient's leg somewhat at the knee, dorsiflex the ankle firmly, and strike the Achilles tendon. Feel and watch for plantar flexion. These are 2+ responses. Support your foot.
And this is the picture or the video that shows the sensory ataxia. Here the patient has a destruction in the gracile fibers by the cephalus. While he is opening his eyes, he is okay to some extent, but when he closes his eyes, the swinging will increase due to the fact that the eyes were supporting the cerebellum, helping it to perform its function in coordination. But when he closes his eyes, and the proprioception in the gracile is damaged, so that the cerebellum cannot maintain the equilibrium and the patient will swing. As you see, you should support your patient, otherwise he will fall down. Now we will, before starting the descending track, somebody asked me why only the proprioception is affected by the cephalus. Remember that you have taken in the first year that we have receptors in the cell membrane. These receptors control the entry of drugs, hormones, bacteria, and virus. And the cephalus is called by spiral bacteria that is allowed to enter the cells of proprioception, so they are affected due to the presence of the specific receptors allowing this entry in the cell membrane of the cell. Now we will discuss the descending tracts. The descending tracts are actually 11, 2 for the pyramidal and 9 for the extra pyramidal. Starting with the pyramidal, it is divided into two parts: corticobulbar parts from the cerebral cortex to the midbrain to supply the motor nuclei of cranial nerves, corticospinal from the cerebral cortex to the anterior horny cells of the spinal cord. So, the first part is responsible for the stimulation of the motor nuclei of cranial nerves 3, 4, 6, 5, 7, 9, 10, 11, 12. While that for responsible for the movement of the head, and the corticospinal stimulate the anterior horny cells responsible for the movement of the body. Now we will start by the corticobulbar tract. The corticobulbar is divided into medial corticobulbar and lateral corticobulbar. Starting with the medial corticobulbar,
It originates from the motor area of the eye field called area 8 here in the cerebral cortex, where the fibers will pass through the corona radiata, then through the genu of the internal capsule. Then in the midbrain, the fibers will occupy the medial part here of the crust cerebri. So it is called medial corticobulbar. As it descends in the midbrain, it gives branches for the oculomotor, trochlear on both sides. When it descends to the pons, it gives branches to the abducens on both sides. So the origin here is the area 8, the course in the corona radiata genu of internal capsule, and in the medial part of crust cerebri, termination 3, 4, 6 on both sides. Now the lateral cortic bulbar, it arises from the motor area 4 in the lower third, as your head is down and body is up. So it arises from the area responsible for supplying the motor nuclei of cranial nerves that is responsible for movement in the head. So it arises from the lower third of the area 4. Then it passes the corona radiata in the genu of internal capsule, and then it passes through the midbrain, where it occupies the lateral part of crust cerebri. And it descends down to the pons to supply the 5th cranial nerve, 7th cranial nerve, and then in the medulla to supply the glossopharyngeal vagus and the accessory and hypoglossal. But take care that it supplies all these nerves on both sides except two parts. The part of the facial nucleus supplying the lower half of the face, and the part of the hypoglossal nerve which supplies the muscle responsible for protrusion of the tongue. These two areas are supplied only from the opposite side. So it supplies the other side in these two parts of nuclei. So the origin from the lower third of area 4, the course in the genu passes, and then the lateral part of crust cerebri, termination 5, 7, 9, 10, 11, 12 on both sides, except the area of the hypoglossal nucleus supplying the muscle responsible for tongue protrusion, genioglossus, and the lower half of the facial nucleus, where they are supplied from the opposite side only. Then here it is a picture of the corticobulbar, the lateral corticobulbar from area 4, lower third, and medial corticobulbar from the motor area of the eye field. Then we will move to the corticospinal. The corticospinal arises from the upper two-thirds of area 4 to supply the muscles of the body, and passes through the corona radiata and then in the genu and the anterior two-thirds of the posterior limb of internal capsule, and then descend downwards. So from the pyramidal pit cells and other cells in upper two-thirds of motor area 4, and it passes through this corona radiata in white matter, and then in the genu anterior two-thirds of posterior limb of internal capsule. Then it passes in the intermediate part of the basis pedunculi or crust cerebri, where the medial part is occupied by the medial corticobulbar and the lateral part is occupied by the lateral corticobulbar. Then it passes through the pons, where it is divided into bundles of pyramidal tract by the transverse pontine fibers. So the pons is a part where the bundle of the pyramidal fibers is divided into several smaller bundles by the passage of the transverse pontine fibers. عشان كده بنقول ده مفرق الفايبرز. Then it will pass through the medulla, where the fibers will be collected again to form the pyramid. So the medulla is a site which is called مجمع الفايبرز, collector. Then we have the important event in the lower half of closed medulla, where 80 to 90% of the fibers cross to the other sides, while 10 to 20% of the fibers pass to the same on the same side. The crossed fibers will form crossed pyramidal tract, while the direct fibers are called direct pyramidal tract. Here, this is the pathway of the corticospinal, from the upper two-thirds of area 4 and in the genu anterior two-thirds of internal capsule, intermediate part of basal blanculi, between the transverse pontine fibers forming the pyramid and then the decussation to form the cross pyramidal and direct pyramid. As you see, the fibers of the cross pyramidal will end in the anterior horny cells, which are present on the opposite side of the body. Very few will pass to the same side, and here also the direct, where the fibers mostly cross also at the end to the other side. Few fibers will terminate on the same side to supply the anterior horny cells. Here we have this animation to show the pathway of the corticospinal fibers, where the impulses will pass through the internal capsule to reach after that the midbrain, and in the midbrain it occupies a large area, which is the intermediate area in the basis blanculi or crust cerebri. We have here, of course, medial corticobulbar and lateral corticobulbar. And in the bones, it is separated into several bundles due to the presence of transverse pontine fibers collected again in the medulla, and then the crossing will take place in the lower half of closed medulla. And this is, of course, the crossed pyramidal, which extends till the end of the spinal cord. Here also another animation for showing the origin and the pathway.
Tract will influence lower motor neurons that innervate musculature in the extremities and trunk. The axons of upper motor neurons begin their descent to the spinal cord by passing through the corona radiata and internal capsule. As the fibers reach the brainstem, they enter the middle portion of the cerebral peduncle. As they pass through the base of the pons, the fiber bundles are separated by the many pontine nuclei and their projections to the cerebellum, the pontocerebellar fibers. Note that the position of these corticospinal fibers is ventral throughout their course through the brainstem. At the most caudal portion of the medulla, most of the fibers begin to course dorsally and cross the midline. This is known as the motor decussation. Note that some axons do not cross the midline. The fibers that have crossed entered the lateral portion of the spinal cord and are known as the lateral corticospinal tract. At upper cervical levels, the lateral corticospinal tract influences lower motor neurons going to neck and shoulder muscles. The medial fibers in the lateral corticospinal tract at cervical levels influence lower motor neurons that innervate upper extremity musculature, especially distal muscles. Fibers that did not cross in the medulla are known as the ventral corticospinal tract. These fibers usually cross the midline as they approach their targets and influence lower motor neurons that innervate trunk musculature. As lumbar levels of the cord are reached, the tract becomes considerably smaller. Lower motor neurons at lumbar levels of the spinal cord innervate musculature of the thigh. Lower motor neurons at sacral levels of the spinal cord innervate musculature of the leg and foot.
Now we will move to the extrapyramidal tracts. The extrapyramidal tracts, they are motor descending fibers that will not pass through the pyramid of the medulla. There are actually two main groups: extrapyramidal tracts from the cerebral cortex to midbrain, and extrapyramidal tracts from the midbrain, pons, and medulla to the spinal cord. So we have two main parts: from cerebral cortex to the midbrain, and from the midbrain and brainstem, brain, pons, and medulla, to the anterior horny cells of the spinal cord. So we will discuss these type of fibers as they will appear in the spinal cord. Here we will start by the extrapyramidal tracts, dividing them in the spinal cord into two main groups: three single and three paired. Three single because they have only one 4, robrospinal, olivospinal, sulcomarginal, while the three paired have two forms, lateral and ventral. Lateral and ventral tectospinal, lateral and ventral reticulospinal, lateral and ventral vestibulospinal. Remember tectospinal by the word television, reticulospinal by radio, vestibulospinal by video. Then we will start by the three segments. But before starting, we should remember that anything arising from the midbrain will be crossed, and anything arising from the pontomedullary junction will be direct. So that we have robrospinal coming from the red nucleus, so it is crossed. We have lateral and ventral tectospinal television arising from the midbrain, so they are, of course, crossed. Here we have the robrospinal and the lateral and ventral tectospinal, both of them are crossed. While the tracts arising from the pontomedullary junction are direct, like the olivospinal is direct and the lateral and ventral vestibulospinal, el هو el video. So this is the olivospinal zetuna and lateral and ventral vestibulospinal video, both of them are direct. Here we have three tracts that will not follow this rule, which is the sulcomarginal arising from the whole brain stem, so it is not following the rule at all, sulcomarginal, and the same thing for the reticulospinal, lateral and ventral reticulospinal or radio. Sulcomarginal and lateral and ventral reticulospinal. Start with the rubrospinal. As its name denotes, it arises from the red nucleus of the midbrain superior level, and it is arising from the midbrain, so it should make a decussation, and this decussation is present here in the ventral position, because we have another decussation which is more dorsal, coming from the tecto or the tectum to form the tectospinal. So this decussation is called ventral tegmental decussation, and then we'll descend downwards in the spinal cord to end in the anterior horny cell. As you see, this tract is present in all the spinal cord except the lumbar level. So it is present cervical, upper and lower thoracic. Then we have the olivospinal or zetuna. Here olivospinal arises from the inferior olive of the midbrain, and as it is arising from the medulla, it is a direct and it will end in the anterior horny cells, but it is present only in the cervical level. Yep, as a tuna, only in the cervical level. Then we have the third form of a single fiber, which is a sulcomarginal. So it is related to the sulcus here. This sulcomargin is nothing but the continuation of the medial longitudinal bundle, which is an associative bundle in the brain stem, and it descends or continues in the spinal cord in the form of this sulcomarginal. Take care that the pyramid is more lateral, so that don't make any mistake in identification of this tract by saying this is direct pyramidal. No, it is the sulcomarginal, and the direct pyramidal is the tract which is lateral to it. This is related to the sulcus. The sulcomarginal, as we have said, it is a continuation of medial lumbar bundle, and it terminates in the anterior horny cells, and it is present in all the levels of the spinal cord. Now we will move to the television, tectospinal. Here it arises from the tectum, and it makes a decussation because it is in the midbrain. But this decussation is called dorsal tegmental decussation, because we have ventral tegmental decussation of what? Of rubrospinal. And then after it descends downwards of the spinal cord, it is divided into two tracts, lateral tectospinal, ventral tectospinal. Lateral tecto is latifa. Latifa is present only in the cervical level, like zetuna. هنا in latifa or zetuna, only in the cervical level. But here we have the ventral tectospinal. It continues downwards, but it is present in all the levels except the lumbars, exactly like the rubrospinal. Now move to the video, lateral and ventral vestibulospinal. It arises from the vestibular nuclei. The vestibular nuclei are four nuclei. They are present in the bones, and the inferior extends to the upper part of medulla. So we have these four superior lateral, medial, and inferior. From the lateral vestibular nucleus arises the lateral vestibulospinal, and it is a direct tract because it is arising from pontomedullary junction, and it is present in all the levels of the spinal cord. It is very important as it increases the tone in the extensors so that support your body against gravity. But the ventral vestibulospinal, or FIFI arises from the lateral, medial, and inferior. Although it arises from three nuclei, it is ending. It is present only in the cervical, not present lower down. So in the cervical, we have three tracts that are present only in the cervical. We have Zatuna, Latifa, Fifi. Now, here it is the ventral vestibulospinal, arising from the vestibular nuclei, three vestibular nuclei, and it is direct. It terminates the anterior horn cell and increases the tone in the extensors of the upper limb, but it does not reach the lower limb at all, so it is present only in the cervical level. Here we have the radio, lateral and ventral reticulospinal. Reticulo coming from the reticular formation, which is an extensive tissue present in the brainstem formed of reticular cells. And these cells have axons. These axons will form the lateral and ventral reticulospinal. Here we have the lateral is crossed, LRC. The lateral is crossed while the ventral is direct. Here we are not following the rule previously discussed. Here we have a separate rule. The lateral is crossed, the ventral is direct, and both of them are present in all the levels of the spinal cord surrounding the gray matter. So these two tracts surrounding the gray matter, the lateral and ventral reticulospinal, and they send impulses to the anterior horn cells together with the sympathetic nuclei present in the lateral horn in the thoracic and upper two lumbar. Remember, all the people have radio, but not all the people have television or video, so that the reticulospinal is present in all the level of the spinal cord. The ventral and lateral reticulospinal are present in all the levels of the spinal cord. Now we have fixed tracts, fixed ascending, gracile, ventral spinocerebellar, lateral and ventral spinothalamic, spinotectal, spinoolivary. And we have fixed nuclei, substantia gelatinosa of Rolandi, main sensory nucleus, anterior commissural, posterior commissural nuclei, anterior and posterior medial motor nuclei. And we have fixed short tracts, Lissauer tract and fasciculi propri. And we have fixed five descending tracts, the cross pyramidal, sulcomarginal, ventral and lateral reticulospinal, and one vestibule. Which one? Not Fifi. No, it is the other vestibule, which will be lateral vestibulospinal. So remember very well that we have the radio all through the spinal cord. Now this is the whole section of the cervical level. This is the gracile, cuneate, dorsal spinocerebellar, ventral spinocerebellar, lateral and ventral spinothalamic, spinotectal, spinoolivary. Lissauer tract, substantia propria, comma-shaped. Here we have the substantia gelatinosa, main sensory nucleus, anterior and posterior commissural, anterior and posterior medial motor, anterior and posterior lateral motor, and this is the central motor. Here we have additional three motor nuclei for the origin of the cervical plexus. So we have five motor nuclei for the cervical plexus. On the other side, we have the sulcomarginal direct pyramidal, and then we have the ventral and lateral reticulospinal, and then we have the ventral and lateral tectospinal, and then we have ventral and lateral vestibulospinal. This is the olivospinal, which stands alone, and this is the cross pyramidal, and in the vicinity of this cross pyramidal, we have the rubrospinal, the rubrospinal. So this is gracile, and this is the cuneate, dorsal spinocerebellar, ventral spinocerebellar, lateral spinothalamic, ventral spinothalamic, spinotectal, spinoolivary. Then we have the cross pyramidal, then we have the direct pyramidal, then we have the rubrospinal related to the cross pyramidal. We have here the olivospinal alone. We have here the sulcomarginal related to the direct pyramidal. We have the two radio ventral and lateral, two tecto, and the two video. RTV. This is the section again. You can examine yourself. Be a fighter like this young plant. It is a survivor plant without any special care. It is from the human being. It is a surviving plant. Be like this plant, please. Thank you very much.